I'm Alan Hall, CEO of WeatherGuard. Here at WeatherGuard, we make lightning protection easy. Lightning zoning of radomes is a process where we try to identify where lightning is likely to attach to the aircraft, and also in that process define how much energy is applied to a particular part of the aircraft. Lightning zoning process, and the sort of the step-by-step in which to do this process, is defined in an SAE document, SAE ARP 5414, and the current revision is B. That guidance material has pictures and diagrams and walks you through the process of lightning zoning, but we want to try to simplify that a little bit for the most common radomes. So nose radomes, for example, lightning zone 1A is where most nose radomes are located. And lightning zone 1A means that the radome may experience up to 200,000 amps of current, and as it may see a particular set of voltage waveforms. So it's what it means is it's an initial attachment area where lightning is likely to start off attached to the aircraft. And if you ever see any videos on YouTube or things of the sort, you can kind of see where lightning is attached to the wingtips or the tail. You see burn marks, those kind of things. The nose radome's in the same place. It's an extremity of the aircraft, and lightning is likely to start there. Now, the nose radomes are a lightning zone 1A, and what the A means in that is there's low expectation of hang-on. So what that means is that even though the lightning channel may start on the nose radome as the aircraft moves, that channel is going to move further back on the aircraft on a nose radome in particular. So what that means is that you may see a big current pulse happen on the nose radome up to 200,000 amps, but some of the continuing current will not be applied to the nose radome because the channel is actually moving further back on the airplane. So nose radomes tend to be in lightning zone 1A. Satcom radomes like a GoGo, Viasat, Honeywell, those radomes tend to be in lightning zone 2A because they're on the fuselage. So lightning zone 2A means places where the lightning channel is sweeping, but it has low expectation of hang-on. So it would come over the radome and actually attach to the radome and keep going down the aircraft. That's a lightning zone 2A. Lightning zone 2A, the peak current there is only expected to be 100,000 amps. And the voltages there are a little bit different than lightning zone 1A. So let's just talk about the lightning testing and what this means in terms of zone 1A versus lightning zone 2A. In lightning zone 1A, you're going to expect a current pulse of 200,000 amps. So 1A is 200,000 amps. In lightning zone 2A, the peak current is going to be 100,000 amps. So it's a factor of two difference between zone 1A and zone 2A. The energy difference between those two is significant. So in lightning zone 1A, you're going to have an action integral, which is a measure of energy, essentially, of an action integral of 2 million. In lightning zone 2A, it's only going to be 250,000. So it's a factor of eight difference between lightning zone 1A and lightning zone 2A. So you can do things a little bit differently in terms of your lightning protection between those two areas because the energy and the amplitudes are lower in lightning zone 2A than 1A. The other part or piece of this is the voltage testing and the sort of voltages that a nose radome will experience versus a SATCOM, a dorsal radome. So a nose radome is going to experience voltages that are, and if you look at the test spec, the voltages are much slower. So you see a kind of a slow rising voltage. So what that represents is the aircraft and the nose of the airplane is coming towards this cloud over here as it approaches. Basically the speed of the aircraft, the voltage will rise, and then the lightning activity starts. On a dorsal radome and something in lightning zone 2A, the voltages are applied with an electrode right above the radome, and you're applying voltages based on distance. And we can walk through that in a different video. But essentially, the voltage increases as you go further back. So the tests are really different, particularly with the voltage tests are different. The current tests are obviously different because of the different amplitudes. Now, the guidance material, which is ARP 5414B, walks through all this. You can pick up that spec at SAE.org. That's the best place to find that document. And to if you're in the business or the process of designing a radome or building a radome, you really want to try to figure out what lightning zone your radome is in, because you're going to do a lot of things differently. Now, for the sort of the odd radome, the radome like an AWACS, where you got a big rotodome sitting on top of the aircraft spinning all the time, or and some of the surveillance aircraft where you have a long, almost like a canoe-shaped radome on the bottom of the aircraft, those radomes are so large that they can change the lightning zoning, where lightning will likely to attach. So on the rotodome, it's so big and massive that it may be in lightning zone one, so lightning may initially attach there, even though it's sort of mounted on the back of the fuselage. And some of the surveillance radomes, the bottom radomes, can get so tall and wide that they actually change the lightning zoning. So those bottom radomes can be in lightning zone one also. So it's important to try to identify those things up front. The FAA or EASA are very helpful in helping determine those things. Here at WeatherGuard, we've been doing lightning zoning for over 25 years. If you have any questions about lightning zoning, please give us a call. We can help you out. You can visit our website and we can walk you through how to determine your zoning so you get the right zoning and you can design the radome properly the first time. So if you have any questions about lightning zoning, please reach out and give us a call today.